Hello everyone, my name is Olivier Jimenez. I work in Montpellier in France. I'm very glad and honored to give the first talk of this session on the recent advances in capture recapture. I would like to thank the organizers of the conference, and in particular Sarah and Josepha for all their hard work, and also the IT guys for accommodating my constraints. I apologize to them and to Lucille for not being here with you today. Thank you, Lucille, for sharing the session in my absence. And thank you all for coming to our session. You are in good hands with Lucille. My talk is a review of Capture Recapture with a focus on the ecological questions that have been asked over the last decade, as well as the methods that have been developed to address these questions. The slides of my talk, along with the analysis, the data, and the codes I used, are available from this link here on the slide on GitHub. First things first, what is capture recapture? Well, this cartoon by Hollanders nails it. It summarizes nicely the principle of capture recapture. You have two fish staring at a worm on a hook. The fish above has a tag, 361. It says to the other untagged fish, so I said, fool me once, fool me twice. Hey, what have we got here? And you have all the elements of capture recapture. More seriously, capture recapture works by capturing, marking animals, and recapturing them. Let's take two examples, one on mice with cages and physical capture on the left, and the other one with tigers with non-invasive methods on the right, and camera traps in trees here. On the first row, what you have is the capture of animals. This is your sample one, your first sample. On the second row, you mark the animals and you release them. This, you have the invasive method on the left with mice, and the non-invasive method with tigers and the photo identification on the right. On the third row, you recapture the animals, and this is your sample two. On the fourth row, well, in this new sample you just collected, and the sample two, you have some individuals that have already been captured and marked in the sample, in the first sample, in sample one, and others that have not. And this is the proportion of marked animals that gives you an estimate of the detection probability. In turn, this estimated detection probability can be used to correct the observed counts of animals and get an unbiased estimate of abundance. Capture recapture is not new. It was first used by Pierre-Simon Laplace in the 18th century to estimate the size of the French population. And so because it's not new, I had to focus my review on a specific period. I went for the last decade, from 2009 to 2019, sorry, and this led me to consider a bit more than 5,000 scientific papers. Before we dive into the results, I should start by a disclaimer and by warning you. I fell into the capture-recapture potion when I was a young scientist, with the precious help from Jean-Dominique Le Breton. Jean-Dominique is on retirement now, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank him for giving me the little push I needed to jump into the potion. So you have me as an Obelix here, the Jean-Dominique as Asterix, and the potion here of Capture Recapture. Okay, let's start. I have organized the results in two sections. The first one is about the ecological questions that Capture Recapture can help you address. There is a main trend one can observe from the literature review. Folks in the field have been working on ecological patterns, then process, and now they are back working on patterns again. Let me explain. In the 80s, it was all about estimating abundance. Then, in the 90s, we became interested in the mechanisms, in the processes that drive variation in abundance, the engine of population dynamics, that is to say, survival. In the last decade, the focus of my literature, of my review here, of my talk, there has been a significant shift to studying transitions between ecological states, like dispersing from one side to the other, starting breeding, that is making a transition from non-breeder to breeder, or getting a disease, that is to say, making a transition between a state sane, for example, and a state sick. And folks in capture recapture have also studied Demographic parameters like recruitment, growth rate, migration, and above all, dispersal. Talking about dispersal, I strongly recommend this paper by Hugo Carella and colleagues, which is a review of the methods to study dispersal. In addition to transitions, what is striking is that abundance and its estimation has been the focus of a lot of work over the last decade. For example, with specially explicit capture recapture models. So we have from patterns to process and back to patterns. What is even more striking is that the field has come full circle with the rise of integrated population models, which combine individual and population level data. We will get back to these models in a few slides. In the 5,000 papers over the last decade, capture recapture is used mostly for animals, rarely for plants, and it's all about vertebrates and many different species. What are the hot topics in capture recapture? I analyzed the content of the 5,000 papers to answer this question, not by hand obviously, but using a method called topic modeling. I don't have time to explain the method, but in a nutshell, it's a statistical technique that allows you to discover meaningful groups of words or topics that occur in a collection of text. The cool thing is that our speakers got you covered. Their talks basically cover the hot topics I identified in the analysis. That's kind of awesome. Let's introduce our speakers then. So you have Lucille Maresco with Disease Ecology. You have Christophe Barbeau with the threats to biodiversity and the pressure of climate and fisheries on seabird demography. You have Antica Kulina with Evolution Ecology and in particular life history trade-offs. Ana Sanz Aguilar with Behavioral Ecology and Foraging Patterns. And Pierre Dupont and Cyril Milleret, who will talk about population management and monitoring at large scales. So because our speakers will do a much better job than me to talk about the ecological questions, I'm not going to tell you more about that. Instead, I will focus my interest from now on the methods. And the field of capture recapture is original in that it has stimulated lots of methodological developments. The most obvious developments are about marking. When we talk about capture-recapture, the first thing we need to do is to mark animals, to be able to recognize them individually in the future. The least we can say about the last decade of research is that there's been a lot of thinking on how to mark animals without perturbing or manipulating them. This is a good thing. And this is non-invasive marking methods. One method is photo identification through camera trapping. It is used on species that have specific coat patterns, for example, like the two links on these pictures. On top, you have two pictures that are taken from the same individual, and same thing on the bottom. Another technique is genetic tagging. Briefly speaking, you collect whatever material you can in the field, from which you can do genotyping and you can identify animals individually using their DNA. I recommend this paper by Lamb and colleagues in which genetic tagging is very nicely reviewed. Once you have the data, the next question is how to analyze them with an ecological question in mind, of course. There has been a rise of dynamic models, that is, models for time series data, explicitly acknowledging the existence of hidden processes. What do I mean by hidden process? Well, let's think for a moment about capture-recapture data. We have a series of zeros and ones, one if an animal is detected and zero for non-detected. This is what you see, what you observe. However, this is not what you're actually interested in. What you're interested in is knowing whether the individual, the animal, is alive or dead. And the hidden process here is that of survival. It's only partially observed. When you do not detect an individual, the question is whether it's alive or dead. and the time series of alive and dead states is driven by the survival probabilities in green here on this slide. And from these states, alive or dead, you get detections or non-detections, with some probabilities, detection and non-detection, in green also on the slide. These models are called state-space models, and also they're called hidden Markov models, that are particular cases of state-space models in which the sequence of states, alive or dead, is Markovian. In addition to the estimation of survival and detection probabilities, the objective is to estimate the hidden variables or states like any other parameters. For example, we'd like to estimate the disease states to get prevalence, the coordinates of activity centers to say something about home ranges. And we'd like to do that while at the same time accounting for uncertainties. By uncertainty, I mean, for example, in the assignment of states to individuals or in the identification of individuals. To do all that, Bayesian methods have become an important tool in the ecologist's toolbox and the MCMC machinery. The same Bayesian framework also allows incorporating random effects and spatial variation in capture-recapture models. Another trend in the capture-recapture literature is the combination of information. Here you have several rafts, each one corresponding to a different source of information. These are complex models and difficult to navigate. There are two ways of combining models. Let's talk about integrating population models first. You have individual level data. You have individual level data like productivity and capture-recapture data, and population level data like count data. And for each data set, you have a relevant model. The core of integrated population models is a projection matrix that links all pieces together. The main advantage in combining these pieces of information is that you share information on the parameters that are in common between the different sources of information and models, of course. Take fecundity, for example. You have information on this parameter in the productivity data, but also in the count data. This is the same thing for survival. You combine and you increase precision parameter estimates for these specific parameters. You may even be able to estimate parameters that you would not be able to estimate when the data sets are analyzed separately. And I recommend this recent special feature in ecology led by Elie Zipkin and colleagues if you're interested in the topic. Another way of combining different sources of information does not actually require a projection matrix to link all models together. Take, for example, capture-recapture data. As we have seen earlier, we may distinguish the observation, detections and non-detections, from what we'd really like to say something about, the demography. And then we can combine with data on unmarked individuals, like for example occupancy data. That's just detections and non-detections on the species. These data bring information on the species distribution. When the species is present in the patch, well, it means that there is at least one animal, which in turn is an information that may be shared with the capture-recapture data to improve the estimation of abundance, of course. On the topic, I recommend this awesome paper by Catherine Sun and colleagues, if you'd like to know more. Okay, much has been done and written in the last decade in capture-recapture. Is there anything left to work on in the field of capture-recapture? Well, the short answer is yes. Technology is changing everything. On this cartoon, you have two characters. One on the left is saying to the other, "What do you see yourself doing in 10 years?" And the other one is answering, "Well, work that can't be done by a robot." Indeed, new technologies produce new data, more data. Take drones, for example, or environmental DNA, or improved tagging systems like passive integrated transponders or PID tags, or even acoustic sampling. These new technologies are nice. However, there is still a lot of work that can't be done by robots. Big data is not the panacea. Think of observational bias in citizen science data, for example, where you collect data only where people are actually living, which induces a huge bias in the species distribution. We will still need to think of how to use these technologies to collect data. Survey design is key here. And there is this quote from Jean-Dominique Le Breton in his ecological monograph paper. An applied statistician knowledgeable in capture recapture should often be consulted for both the design and analysis of capture recapture or capture resighting studies, especially if the population issues are complex. On the topic of survey design, I recommend this recent paper published in Methods in Ecology and Evolution by Williams and Brown. Okay, from an ecological point of view, we need to think of species in their ecosystem to better understand and better protect them. And this means going from population ecology to community ecology and studying interactions. We're currently working on multi-species integrated population models that might help doing just that. Another avenue of research is spatial capture-recapture models and how to infer home ranges in particular. But these models, these spatially explicit capture-recapture models, can and will help doing so much more. For a recent overview of spatial capture-recapture models, I recommend this recent paper by Andy Roll and colleagues published in Ecography. Last but not least, it's not taking a big risk to bet that more research will occur on the combination of information. We've seen that combining capture-recapture with data on unmarked animals can be useful, but capture-recapture data can or could be combined with other types of data. Take telemetry data, for example, including satellite telemetry data and GPS. Or spatial capture-recapture data, of course. Or another example with batch data, that is individuals that are marked in groups instead of individually. Batch marking is a technique useful for insects, for example. It's interesting to note that these data can be analyzed with hidden Markov models or state space models. This raises the question, can hidden Markov models become a unifying framework for data combination? Well, the answer is probably yes, and the fathers of integrated population models, Panayotis Besbeas and Byron Morgan, have recently published a paper showing how integrated population models can be formulated as hidden Markov models. My last slide will be about what I value most in capture-recapture research. Namely, cross-fertilization between disciplines and collaborations. Collaborations have been initiated between ecologists and climate scientists. We need more, obviously. Artificial intelligence is the new kid on the block. I suspect it's not just a buzz when I see more and more work on deep learning for image processing and machine learning for parameter estimation and model selection. Of course, the involvement of statisticians and computer scientists will remain important, especially with the combination of information and data sets becoming bigger and bigger. Last, I would like to give a shout out to people involved in workshops. Capture-recapture folks have been at the forefront of the organization of workshops in ecology. I guess we will all agree to say that workshops are great because they help disseminate methods and software, they foster new collaborations, and they contribute in building an inclusive and friendly community. Cross-fertilization between disciplines, collaborations, and friendliness, well, these are the three characteristics of the capture-recapture research community I have cherished much over the years. And that's all, folks. Thank you for listening.